Good morning and welcome to service. We are River's Edge. Your praise team will lead you in music today. So please stand and join along with us if you would like to stand. We're going to start off today with Forever. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King.
His love endures forever. His love endures forever.
For the life that's been reborn,
His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful.
Sun.
His love endures forever,
and by the grace of God we will carry on.
His love endures forever.
God's grace and peace to you as we join in worship on this second Sunday of the Lenten season and also the last Sunday of February. It is good to be together. My name is Jenny Arneson, and I serve as the lead pastor here at the Sun Prairie United Methodist Church, and we welcome those that are gathered in person and those that are joining us online today. And as a reconciling congregation, we always remind you that this church extends a wide welcome to all God's people, and we believe that we extend God's expansive love when we do welcome all people as Jesus did. And we share that love as we worship together, as we grow in our faith, as we care for others, and as we serve God in our communities. So we hope that you'll feel God's life-giving touch in this time of worship today. And when you came in, you received an attendance card, and that's important that we know that you are with us. So we hope you'll fill that out and put it in the offering plates as we leave worship today. And if you're joining us online, if you're on the YouTube channel, you can simply put your name in the comments section to let us know that you're with us, or you can go over to our church website at sunprairieumc.org and be able to register your attendance electronically. And if you are a guest with us this morning, we welcome you and extend a warm welcome and hope that you'll stop by our Welcome Center so that you can introduce yourself and we can get to know you a little bit better and give you some more information about our ministries that we share. And if you're a guest with us online, we hope you'll go over to our church website and browse around and see who we are and the ministries that we share together. But now we begin worship by pouring water into our baptismal font. And as the water is poured out, we are reminded that our baptism joins us together as one. And Scripture affirms that we are one body in Christ. There's one God, one faith, one baptism. May we remember our baptism and be thankful. Now I invite you to stand as we sing another song.
Thank you. My name is Bill Ancio. Would you please join me in our call to worship? Come, let us worship the God who came to seek and save the lost. Let us worship the God who came to seek and save each of us. Sometimes we feel too small and insignificant to be noticed by Jesus. Yet God provides a tree for us to climb to see Jesus, or a table for us to eat with Jesus. The tree and the table are faithfulness, compassion, love, hope, and joy. Let us welcome God into our homes, our hearts, and at our tables. Let us give of ourselves in this time of worship that we may know God. Let us joyfully and with gratitude worship God. Our first scripture reading is Psalm 103. Let my whole being praise the Lord. Let everything inside me bless God's holy name. Let my whole being bless the Lord and never forget all God's good deeds. How God forgives all your sins, heals all your sickness, saves your life from the pit, crowns you with faithful love and compassion, and satisfies you with plenty of good things, so that your youth is made fresh like an eagle's. The Lord works righteousness, does justice for all who are oppressed. God made his ways known to Moses, made his deeds known to the Israelites. The Lord is compassionate and merciful, very patient, and full of faithful love. God won't always play the judge. God won't be angry forever. God doesn't deal with us according to our sin or repay us according to our wrongdoing, because as high as heaven is above the earth, that's how large God's faithful love is for those who honor God. As far as east is from west, that's how far God has removed our sin from us. Like a parent feels compassion for their children, that's how the Lord feels compassion for those who honor God. Because God knows how we are made. God remembers we're just dust. The days of a human life are like grass. They bloom like a wildflower, but when the wind blows through it, it's gone. Even the ground where it stood doesn't remember it. But the Lord's faithful love is from forever ago to forever from now to those who honor God. And God's righteousness reaches to the grandchildren of those who keep God's covenant and remember to keep God's commands. The Lord has established God's throne in heaven, and God's kingdom rules over all. You divine messengers, bless the Lord. You who are mighty in power and keep God's word, who obey everything God says, bless God. All you heavenly forces, bless the Lord. All you who serve God and do God's will, bless God. All God's creatures, bless the Lord. Everywhere throughout God's kingdom, let my whole being bless the Lord. A word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
I invite the children that are here to come up for our time together. Do I have some? Come on up. In fact, let's sit at this table today, since we have an opening. Come on up. I got to get my box. Hello, Nina. Just enough spaces, but we can have more. Anyone else wants to come up? And Mr. Crockett has our offering basket if you have something. All right. Hi, do you like it up here? Yeah, you could sit up here some Sunday. These are open tables for everyone to sit at. Oh, look, these two people are very brave. They sat up here. Well, today I brought this box with me, and I've brought it before. I usually bring it every season of Lent because I call it my Lent box. And inside, I have all sorts of different treasures that I've collected. Because during the season of Lent, what we're asked to do is look at ourselves, to kind of look inside of ourselves and kind of see, are we, and ask ourselves some questions. Are we living the way Jesus taught us to live? Are we living the way Jesus would have us live? With all the stories we have in the Bible that Jesus teaches people how to live and how to love God and how to love other people, how to help people, are we doing those kind of things? But sometimes, you ever find out that you need a reminder? Your parents ever have to remind you how to behave? Yeah, I need reminders too. So that's why I have my Lent box. So in my Lent box, I have some things to remind me of how to live. So I'm just going to pull a few things out. So, first of all, you like Legos? Yeah? You have Legos at home? So I love, I like Legos too. So Legos remind me that when I'm living the way Jesus wants me to live, then I would be building up other people. So if I wanted to encourage you to do something, I would encourage you and I would be building you up. Just like Legos, we can build things. So that reminds me to help build other people up. Then I have, you know what that is? A reflector, isn't it? Sometimes we put reflectors on our bikes or something. And then I have a flashlight. And in the Bible, Jesus says, I am the light of the world. And then this reminds me that when I shine a flashlight on a reflector, it reflects light, doesn't it? Yeah, this isn't too strong of a flashlight, but it reflects light. And that reminds me, am I reflecting God's light to other people in my life? So that reminds me of that. Then I have this little level. Have you ever seen a level? You've probably seen a big level. So that's a level. So if we set that on the table, that little bubble is supposed to be right in the middle. And it is, which means our table is level. That's the good news. So this reminds me, am I keeping my life level? Am I balanced in my life and how I'm living my life? Let's just look at a couple more. Now this one, maybe you've seen these, but not like this. Ever seen those doors that have a place where you can look out? Sometimes we call it a peephole. So when you look through that, you can see who's on the other side of the door, can't you? So I got this, I put this in my Lent box, because when we look through one of these, it gives us this big, wide view. So I can see the people over here, even though I'm looking straight ahead. And I can see Pat and Jim, who are sitting over here, even though I'm looking straight ahead. So it gives me this wide view. And that reminds me, am I having a wide view of how I look at the world and how I look at other people? Because that's what Jesus wants us to do, is look at the big picture. Then, to go along with our Lenten theme, our theme is for Lent is come to the table. That's why we have these tables up here. But I have this little table. If you look closely, you can see it has silverware on there. There's spoons and forks and knives, and it has little cups. And so that's just a reminder of our theme of come to the table, that we're inviting people to come to tables. Because when we come to the table, we often have conversation. We often eat meals. So are we inviting other people? And then my last thing I'm going to show you is this tree. Now, this kind of looks like, oh, this is exciting, isn't it? You'd love to touch that, wouldn't you? So this kind of looks like the trees outside in winter, doesn't it? Some of the trees that lose their leaves. And so then they look like they don't have any leaves on. They're just barren. So, but in spring, what happens to trees that lost their leaves? What do you think?
They grow new ones. Exactly.
They grow new leaves. And that's what happens in spring. And the word Lent really means spring. So it means new life is going to start coming. So the trees will start to get their leaves on. But then, to go along with our story today that Pastor Brad is going to read in just a bit, I have this little person. I'm going to stick him right in the tree. Oh, see if he can stay. He stayed first service. There he is. So Pastor Brad is going to be reading us a story from the Bible that talks about this little guy, and his name is Zacchaeus. This is a kind of a fun name. Zacchaeus. And so Zacchaeus in the Bible, the Bible says he was short. He was just like a short person. So he wasn't so tall, and Jesus was passing through his town, and he wanted to see Jesus. So to get a better view, what did he do? He climbed the tree so he could see Jesus. And then when Jesus was passing by, Jesus saw Zacchaeus in the tree, and Zacchaeus, he looks up and he says, Zacchaeus, come down from the tree. I'm coming to your house for dinner. So Jesus invites himself to Zacchaeus' house. But then when he gets there, he shares God's love with Zacchaeus and his family, and Zacchaeus was changed. Because Zacchaeus was kind of a person that had done some bad things. He had cheated some people. And so after Jesus shared God's love, he was a changed person. And that's what happens during Lent, is we're supposed to be changed by God's love. So those are my things in my Lent box today. So you could make a Lent box if you wanted to. You could find some things that remind you of how we're supposed to live, and you can find a box. You don't have to have a box so big, but you can find a box and be able to share some things in your box about how to live, okay? All right, why don't we have our prayer together, and then we'll lead the congregation in the Lord's Prayer, okay? So let's pray. Dear God, we do thank you that you give us reminders all the time about how to live our lives and how to be changed by your love and how to share your love with others. So we ask that you would continue to change our lives so that we can share love with each other. And we pray this in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, thank you for coming to my table today. This is actually easier to get up than when I sit on that stool.
The good news, you've been invited, no matter what others may say, your darkest sins will be forgiven, and you will always have a place at the table of grace. The cup's never empty, the plate's always full, and it's never too late to come and be filled with love never ending. You're always welcome at the table of grace. So come, you weak and heavy-hearted, don't try to hide your earthly scars, for in his eyes we all are equal. Don't be afraid, come as you are at the table of grace. The cup's never empty, the plate's always full, and it's never too late to come and be filled with love never ending. You're always welcome at the table of grace. So let the first become the last. Let the poor put kings to shame. Their willing hearts will be their treasure. By the power of Jesus' name, at the table of grace, the cup's never empty, the plate's always full, and it's never too late to come and be filled with love never ending. You're always welcome at the table of grace. At the table of grace, the cup's never empty, the plate's always full, and it's never too late. Come and be filled with love ever ending. You're always welcome at the table of grace. Everyone's welcome at the table of grace.
Throughout the Gospels, Jesus shared meals with others. In a world where there is an upsurge of hate and division, and a growing uncertainty about what the future holds, God calls us to make space for all of God's children at the table. As we sit at the table together, we can learn more about each other and get to know the God who created us all even better.
Good morning. Good morning. I am Pastor Brad Mather, and I'm the pastor of our Caring Ministries here. And it's great to be able to bring the word to you this morning. As Jenny said, I'm going to be talking about Zacchaeus, one of the favorite stories that we have in the Bible. Let's have that passage. This one comes from Luke. Listen for the word of God, if you will. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through town. A man named Zacchaeus, a ruler among tax collectors, was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but being a short man, he couldn't because of the crowd. So he ran ahead, and he climbed up a sycamore tree so he could see Jesus, who was about to pass that way. When Jesus came to that spot, he looked up and said to Zacchaeus, "Come down at once. I must stay in your house today." So Zacchaeus came down at once, happy to welcome Jesus. Everyone who saw this grumbled, saying, "He's gone to be with the guest of a sinner." Zacchaeus stopped and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, I give half of my possessions to the poor, and if I've cheated anyone, I repay them four times as much." Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this household because he too is a son of Abraham. The human one came to seek and save the lost." A word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. In our first service this morning, we celebrated Scout Sunday. And we had a couple kids who were scouts, and they came up. And also, Claire invited those who were a part of the scouting program at some point in their life to stand up. So let's do that today. If you've ever been a part of the scouting program, stand up. Okay, a good share of us. Thank you. Now, to get going here, I want to offer something that I do every once in a while. And nobody's ever got this, so it's a good thing. But I'm going to offer $1 million and a new car if you can recognize who the person is that you see up on the screen. So, Amanda, could we have that? So, for $1 million and a new car, who is that?
George.
Who? Me? It's me.
A new car!
There's a reason why Jenny's the lead pastor, so you see her about those kinds of things, okay? $1 million in a new car. When my brother saw this picture, he said two things. He said, "You look like Howdy Doody." And then he said, "Your fly is down." I don't know. I'm starting with this photo on Scout Sunday because scouting was an important part of my life. I was a Cub Scout and I was a Boy Scout. I never made Eagle, but I became a Star Scout, and one of the merit badges that I earned was a cooking merit badge. Now, I don't remember all the things you needed to do in order to get a cooking merit badge, but I do remember that the final requirements was that you had to cook a meal for the scout leader on one of your camping trips over an open fire. Jack Drake, who was the scout leader at the time and who was a family friend, I asked years later, I said to him, "Jack, how did you survive those merit badge meals?" And he laughed and he said, "Well, it wasn't always easy." And he said, there are two of meals that I remember in particular. He said, one was when the scout soaped the outside of the pots and pans in order to help clean up, you know. But he said he then also soaped the insides of the pots and pans. I said, could you taste the soap? And he said, yep, you could. The other one I remembered was when a scout decided to take the easy way to cook a can of beans. Now, normally what you do, right, is you take off the top and you pour the can of beans into a pot and then you cook them, right? Well, what he did was he just took the can and he threw it into the fire. And yes, I was there that day, that night, and I have to say that it's the only time I've ever seen it rain beans with a loud bang. As for the meal I cooked, well, really wasn't much better. My mom showed me how to make a meal of meat and potatoes in an aluminum foil pouch. So you put the ingredients in, and then you put a little water in there, and you seal it up, and it's supposed to cook. Unfortunately, somehow I nicked the bottom of my pouch, and all the water drained out. And so what I had left was burnt meat and potatoes. During Lent, we're thinking about coming to the table. We're not thinking about coming to a table at a campsite, but we are thinking about coming to God's table. And reminded of today's text that we're invited to God's table despite our flaws and our failures, despite our imperfections. Now, if there was ever anyone in the Bible who brought imperfection to God's table, it was Zacchaeus. You remember the story? Zacchaeus climbs a tree in order to be able to see Jesus, and when Jesus passes underneath it, he says to Zacchaeus, come down and take me to your house. Zacchaeus, of course, is thrilled, honored, but not his neighbors, because he was a tax collector, a ruler among tax collectors. Now, bear in mind that it was the Romans who set the taxes. They determined the amount. And they hired local people to be the tax collectors. And the Romans didn't care how the money got collected. They just were interested in getting their money. And that meant that tax collectors they would make sure that their own pockets would get lined. And so you can imagine the reaction of the people in the village when Jesus went to his house. Now, the story is only 10 verses long. It doesn't give us much details, but Luke's point is clear. God understands our sins, our shortcomings, our imperfections, and still we're invited to God's table. Look at some of the others in the Bible who had tragic flaws. There's Moses, who murdered in cold blood. There's Jacob, who robbed his brother of his inheritance. There's David, who committed adultery. There's Solomon, his son, who was a womanizer. And not to be forgotten, there's Paul. Before his conversion experience, his job was to track down and eliminate followers of Jesus. And yet it's no surprise that Jesus says to Zacchaeus, come down from that tree and let's break bread together. To Jesus, imperfection isn't a deal breaker, not by a long shot. Currently, I'm reading one of the most interesting and thought-provoking books that I've read in a while. It was sent to me by a friend, and the title of the book is Rembrandt is in the Wind, and it was written by a Presbyterian pastor by the name of Russ Ramsey. And in his book, Ramsey Through the Lives of Nine Artists talks about the ways in which their works of art give clarity, give an image of what our faith and our life are to be all about. One of the artists that he highlights is Michelangelo, who is probably most famous for painting the ceiling in the Sistine Chapel. But are you ready for this? Michelangelo didn't like to paint. He thought of it was below him, beneath him. He thought it was child's play. He said anybody could do it. But for Michelangelo, sculpting was entirely different. It represented the ultimate expression of creating beauty. And part of why sculpting was so important to him, because you had to work with the imperfections in the stone that you were carving. You had to find the beauty in the stone. Now, a perfect example of what I'm talking about was the statue of King David that he carved. And it came from a slab of marble that was so big, so immense, that it had its own name. It was called the Giant. And an Italian sculptor like Michelangelo was hired to carve it. But after 2 years, he had done nothing. He couldn't figure out how to go about carving the stone. And so there it sat. He was fired. The stone sat there for a few years, and then another sculptor tried, and he too failed. Michelangelo, though, wasn't the first to try, but he was the third to try. After 16 years, he agreed to try to carve the stone. The city officials had decided, let's give this thing one more try. And then if we can't find somebody to carve it, then we're just going to have to scrap the stone. It was taking up space in the courtyard of the cathedral. But that's when Michelangelo stepped forward. He wasn't the least bit put off by the imperfections, the limitations that the stone presented. Here's what Ramsey has to say about dealing with our limits and imperfections. I love this. He says, living with our limits is one of the ways we enter into beauty we would not otherwise seen, good work we would not otherwise have chosen, and relationships that we would not have otherwise treasured. For the Christian, accepting our limits is one of the ways we are shaped together as living stones into the body of Christ. As much as our strengths are a gift, so are our limitations, our imperfections. For Christmas this year, Becky said to me, why don't we give Lena a toy box? You saw Lena a few minutes ago when her mom, Claire, brought her down here. She's sitting back there with her grandmother and her great-grandmother. Well, I said to Becky, that sounds like a great idea. Every kid's got to have a toy box. And I said, I'll see what I can find. And so I looked online, and I found dozens and dozens of toy boxes. And, you know, thing was that they were all pretty expensive. And so I said, you know, Becky, I said, I can make one myself. I'll make one for her. You know, I just slap some size together and put a lid on it. I mean, you know. And I said to Claire, all I need are the dimensions and the color. Well, a week or so later, Becky and Claire announced that they had found the design they wanted. And they showed me a picture of it. Well, this won't come as a surprise to you, but that the one that they wanted was not your run-of-the-mill toy box. They wanted the Taj Mahal of toy boxes. It was a Montessori design, if that means anything to you. This was, again, as I say, the Taj Mahal of toy boxes. Well, I started to protest, and then I was told that the toy box design was vital to child development. And to choose otherwise would have a lifelong dilatory effect on my beautiful granddaughter. Well, it was clear that the train had already left the station, and so I buckled down and I got to work. Now, I'm not quite finished, but she who must be obeyed, who I live with, has been following the progress, and she tells me that it's good. She likes it. She says it's really good. I think she's even used the word perfect. But here's the thing. When I look at the toy box, what I see are the imperfections. I see where boards are not quite lined up right. I see where I haven't filled the screw holes properly. There are places where the paint isn't right, even though I've tried covering it numbers of times. What I see when I look at that toy box are the imperfections. And that's true with the rest of my life as well. The fact is, I'm obsessed with imperfections in my life. For example, I'm obsessed when it comes to relationships. I want everybody to be happy. I want to fix any problem. I don't want there to be any conflict. When it comes to writing something like a sermon or a Lenten devotional or even an email, sometimes I'll struggle with it for hours, just trying to find the right turn of phrase or find a way to say something just right. I obsess over it. I also obsess over whether or not I'm too selfish and haven't gone the extra mile enough. Truth is, there are not many areas in my life where I don't see my imperfections. Now, the question, of course, is how do I live with it? How do I deal with this obsession? And by the way, I'm quite sure that I'm not alone. I suspect that some here today struggle with that same thing. How do I live with it? How do I dare approach God's table? Well, the answer is that imperfection doesn't preclude my or anybody else's invitation to God's table. Remember the song we used to sing when we were kids? Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. How do I know that even I am invited to God's table? Because the Bible tells me so. Remember that quote that I read just a few minutes ago from Russ Ramsey's book? It's worth repeating. He writes, "Living with limits is one of the ways that we enter into beauty that we would not otherwise seen, good work we would not have chosen, and relationships we would not have treasured. It's our limitations, it's our imperfections that allows us to come to God's table." Michelangelo's statue of David still stands in the Academy Gallery in Florence, Italy. When I was in my misspent youth, I got to see it. I was studying abroad, and we went to Florence, and I got to see it. I was surprised at how tall it was. It's like over 17 feet tall. But if I had a chance to go back, and I hope I do, I'd like to stand before it one more time, remembering that Michelangelo saw the beauty in that imperfect slab of marble. Amen and amen.
Please stand and join along with us.
For everyone born, a place at the table. For everyone born, clean water. A safe place for growing, for everyone born, a star overhead. And God will delight when we are creators of justice and joy, compassion and peace. Yes, God will delight when we are creators. Justice and joy. For woman and man, a place at the table, revising the roles, deciding the shame, with wisdom and grace, dividing the power. For woman and man, a system that's fair. God will delight when we are creators of justice and joy, compassion and peace. Yes, God will delight when we are creators of justice. Voice to be heard, a part in the song. The hands of a child in hands that are wrinkled. For young and for old, the right to belong. And God will delight when we are creators of justice and joy. Abuser abused with need to forgive. In anger, in hurt, a mindset of mercy. For just and unjust, a new way to live. And God will delight when we are creators of justice and joy. Creators of justice, justice and joy. For everyone born, a place at the table, to live without fear and simply to be.
It is often through our prayers that we realize that there is a place at the table for everyone, and that everyone born has a place at the table. As we come to prayer, we always remind you that you can make a prayer request by going to our church website, and there's a prayer request button there that you can click, or you can reach out to the church office and be able to share your prayers, and we'll make sure we lift them in worship and be able to send them out over our prayer chain. I have a couple prayers to lift to you today. A joy to start with, that Pastor Claire had her interviews with the Board of Ordained Ministry this last week, and she got word that she passed those interviews, so she will be ordained as an elder. Yes. So she'll be ordained as an elder in our United Methodist Church and ordained at the Wisconsin Annual Conference this coming June. And then out in the narthex, we have a table with some prayer cloth on, slips of purple cloth, and we invite you during this Lenten season to express a prayer. There's some cloth markers there that you can use, and just write a prayer of hope or a prayer that you are holding this Lenten season, and then all of those prayer slips are going to be woven into an altar paramet that we'll use on our altar next season of Lent. So please share a prayer during this season of Lent. Well, now I do invite us to come into a time in our own way to connect with God through our prayers, through a time of silent prayer, and then I'll also offer us words of prayer. So let us be in a time of silent prayer. Loving God, you are our beginning and our ending, and the one who seeks to work through even us opportunities to share gifts of compassion and mercy with others. So we gather in this Lenten season to worship and to take in the gifts of promise and hope. In Jesus' life, we see what your presence seeks to teach us in our lives. We come thankful for the freedom to worship, thankful for those who have come before us, and thankful that in days past you have saved your people, you have restored souls, you have healed divisions, and offered us your constant presence. God of great compassion, we pray for those whose faith has been shaken, for those who stand bewildered and fearful in the midst of illness or treatments, in the midst of violence or war, in the midst of grief or homelessness, hunger, mental illness, or simply trying to make ends meet for yet another day. We offer to you, God, the ministry of our faith community. Love and lead, enable and encourage us, provide and provoke us to be faithful in the vision that you have placed before us, to be people who reach beyond the doors of our church and invite others to come to the table, a table that you provide and that we are called to set. Held within your love and guided toward the purpose you intend for us and all people, we pray in the name and spirit of Jesus the Christ. Amen. Well, as we come to our time of considering the offerings we make, we know that we make decisions about how we share our gifts and how we share our offerings. So each time we share a gift, it really truly does come out of our blessings, the blessings of our lives, what we have been provided with. So we thank you for the gifts that you share and how those gifts go a long way in helping our ministry within our church and reaching out beyond the doors of our church. And you may make an offering today with our gratitude. We will have our offering plates at the door. Or you can use the QR code that's on the card in the pew pockets. Or you can go to our church website and there's a way of giving electronically that way as well. Or you can continue to mail or bring your offering to the church. And for those that are joining us online, you can give electronically through our church website, or again, mail or bring your offering to the church. And then each week we show you pictures to be able to share what our offerings are going to support and how we are using your offerings. And today we have pictures from a couple of weeks ago when our youth stood at the doors with soup kettles for our Super Bowl of Caring on Super Bowl Sunday. And that collection gathered for $805. And all that money will be shared directly with our Sun Prairie Food Pantry here in our own community. So thank you for that extra gift that you gave for Super Bowl of Caring Day. I love the squeaks. As we continue to journey through this Lenten season, we truly do seek to have our hearts changed, our hearts and our minds and our souls changed by how we know God loves us and loves all people. So we come to this time of confession with humble hearts, knowing that God hears our prayers and that God offers forgiveness. So in that spirit, I invite us to humble ourselves once again in God's presence and offer our confessions with a prayer of confession that is printed in your bulletin and also on the screen. Let us pray together. God of mercy, we have come to worship with wounds aching to be healed, with emptiness aching to be filled, and with joy waiting to overflow. So often we get sidetracked in sorrow or fear or guilt, and we miss your very presence. We want immediate release from our struggles. We cling to ways of being in control in spite of the Spirit who moves beyond our control. We confess the ways we have closed you out of our lives, yet you do not cast us off. You do not tell us to come back later. You love us into understanding. You love us into a saving relationship. Touch us in your mercy and forgive us as we make our silent confessions. Hear the good news. The psalmist has reminded us in worship today that as far as the east is from the west, that is how far God will go to change our transgressions, to move us into new life. Forgiveness is from God, and God's love is from everlasting to everlasting. So holding to that promise, I proclaim to you that we are a forgiven people. Thanks be to God. Amen. During the season of Lent, we have added an affirmation of faith into our order of worship, so I invite us to join together in our affirmation of faith. Let us affirm our Christian faith together. We believe in the faithfulness of God, our Creator, whose love is constantly being poured out on us and on our world, and whose purposes are continually revealed to us. We believe in Jesus the Christ, who reveals the depth of God's love for us. Christ comes to us in the midst of life, offering us healing and hope in our brokenness. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the sustaining and renewing presence of God in our lives and in our world. To walk in the Spirit is to know that each day holds the promise of new life. To live in the Spirit is to experience our lives as a channel of God's love to flow into the world. We believe that God will lead us and strengthen us to share in ministries of love, and that God will use these ministries to renew our world. So may it be. So may we live. Amen. I have a few invitations and opportunities for you before we close worship today. Always a reminder that if you are not receiving our Monday morning devotional Word of the Week or our Thursday email that outlines what's happening in the life and ministry of our congregation, you can reach out to the church office and we'll make sure you get on those email lists. And then in the fellowship hall on the counter near the wall, we have some red boxes to collect jewelry for our garage sale. And each year people bring jewelry that they no longer want, and we restore that a little bit and price it out, and then it is used at the church garage sale to be sold and raise money for the church. So if you have jewelry that you are looking to downsize, you could start to bring that to the church. And because we have a team of people that works on that for several weeks, if you could bring that by March 31st, that would be helpful, and put it in those boxes or bring it to the church office during the week. And then our church during this month or this quarter of January, February, and March is collecting our loose coins, and that will go to a nonprofit organization in Wisconsin known as Keep Wisconsin Cool and Warm Fund. And that this nonprofit organization helps keep the heat and power on for elderly persons, persons with disabilities, and young families with children. So any of your loose coins that you put in the offering plates, or there's a collection box in the narthex, that will be used for the Keep Wisconsin Warm and Cool Fund. And then our next monthly food drive will be coming up in a couple of weeks on March 9th and 10th. And you can bring food to the church on Saturday between 9 and 11, just to the church parking lot, or you can bring it to church with you on Sunday, March 10th. And this month, our food collection will go to Northside Elementary School to their food pantry. And if you'd like a list of specific things that they're looking for, that's on our church website. And then during the season of Lent, with our theme of Come to the Table, we have a collection table out in our narthex where we are collecting spices and sauces and condiments so that we can season the table of others. And we're going to give all of those to Northside Elementary School as well. So if you can take a, there's a list there of specific condiments and sauces that they would like, spices. So you can take a list there and bring those back to church during this season of Lent. And then please join us next Sunday. We'll worship at 8:30 and 10:45, again, both in person and online. And this will be the third Sunday next week in Lent, and we'll also share in the sacrament of Holy Communion. Well, now I invite you to stand to receive our closing blessing. And now as we leave worship, may we share the invitation to come to the table. And as we share that invitation with others, may we also share the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. And may we always have the courage to live as God's grateful people. Amen.
Jesus walked the lonesome valley. He had to walk it by himself. Oh, nobody else could walk it for him. He had to walk.
Just